encounter series, and the way to get your friends to come is advertise the food that we have. Look at the app, you'll see next week we're going to have the food that we have. Every week we're going to individual to the Bible to have an encounter of grace. And of course, New Kingdom series is going to begin in a couple of weeks or less. And we have some new courses apart from the usual. We have Kingdom Discovery, which is totally revamped, and especially for seekers. And also Kingdom Relationship. It's not just for those who are preparing for wedding, but also to enhance your relationship skills. And it's going to have exquisite dinners as well as high tea. And also, of course, Kingdom Cell is for leadership. It's not just taking care of the care group, but also leadership in the marketplace. So, and some of these lessons we're going to be teaching. And also the new one, of course, will be enjoying your possession, following the footsteps of Joshua as they take the people of God into the promised land. So, you know, sign up, do it right now, okay, after the service. Sunday manna today is Hosea 14, verse 7. My people will again live under my shadow, and they will flourish like grain and blossom like vineyards, and they will be as fragrant as the wines of Lebanon. And here to come out a special shield. How many of you like to be protected by the very special shield? A shield over your family, a shield over your finances, a shield over your health. The key is Romans 11, verse 16. If the first portion of the dough offered is holy, then the whole batch is holy. And if the root is holy, so too are the branches. And of course, we've got the context. It's talking about the first fruit. Talk about your tithe. What you have given, first fruit or tithe, that which has been given is holy. But also, amazingly, those that remain, your 90%, is also holy. And the word holy means set apart. It means protected. You recall the story of Jericho, where Joshua said that, Joshua 6 verse 18, you shall suddenly keep clear of the devoted thing, or the holy thing, thing that are set apart for holiness, that you will not become accursed by taking from the devoted thing. The first city they could conquer was Jericho. God said, that is set apart, that is devoted, that is holy. Don't touch it. But you call Achan, first China man. I mean, Achan took something and the whole family was cursed. And as a result of that, they were defeated in the city of Ai. Oh, Pastor, if I don't give my tithe, you're going to be cursed. No, no, no. Then it's the wrong interpretation. It simply means that city has been set aside as holy. Anyone touches it, it's going to be a curse. The same way, when it comes to your finances, when you give it your tithe, it's holy. That tithe is holy. What remained, the 90%? The Bible says it's also holy, and anyone touches it, incur God's wrath. In other words, how many must know what remains is holy? So, Pastor, I got a small amount. Yes, but holy. Set apart, there's going to be that great covering for what you have. And it says here, my people will again live under my shade, and they will flourish like grain and blossom. How do you like to flourish? How do you like to blossom? And how am I going to like to be shining with fragrance? Well, the key is when you have given your tithe, that portion you've given is holy, but that which remains is holy. Anyone try to supper touch your profession, undermine your promotion, anyone try to attack you in terms of the finances, incur God's wrath. So you get that special shield of protection, not just money, but every areas of your life. So that's an amazing blessing that God has for us when we give our tithes and offering.
Hello everyone, and welcome home to RLC. If this is your first time here, head down to the Vineyard Lounge where you can receive a free gift from us and know more about our ministry here in RLC.
We dream of a strong local church, mighty in the grace of God, reaching out with great compassion, disciple and transform by the love of Christ.
For weekly updates and sermon notes, you can download our app. Just search for Renewal Lutheran Church.
Follow us on Instagram at Oasis of Care and Ablaze RLC.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for this beautiful morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, rebuke and bind every foul wicked evil spirit. Can you go from here right now? In Jesus' name, that your word may have free course in the midst of us and other people say, amen. The true story of this elderly lady, 79 years old. Her name is Doreen. He just got off Walmart and after shopping, and he saw a car packed with four young people. He believed that it was a carjacking, so he took off her gun. She happened to have a shotgun, pointed at them, young people, run away from my car. And the four young people took off with great speed, and she was, of course, shaking a little bit. She took her whatever that she has bought, put in the luggage, she got in the car, and tried to start the car. For some reason, he cannot insert the key into the ignition switch. She tried a couple of times. She couldn't until she noticed, actually, her car is a few rows away. Then, of course, embarrassed, he took off to the police station, and he saw the young people there, and they were frozen in fear, because they reported there was a 5-foot-tall elderly lady, white hair, trying to steal their car. Eventually, there was no charge against the elderly lady. How many of us know there is grace even in the police station? And other people say, today we talk about a king called King Hezekiah, that he was astoundingly described as the greatest king. I always thought the greatest king would either be King David or Solomon, but it was Hezekiah, 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 5.
Hezekiah trusted in the Lord. There was no one like him among all the kings of Judah.
That is part of Hezekiah's weaknesses. It was being described as the greatest king with the greatest impact. You know, the Bible is a real book about real human being with real human weaknesses facing real issues, but because they encounter the real God, they're able to leave behind great impacts despite their weaknesses. And today we want to see in what way Hezekiah was considered the greatest king, because he was involved in restoration, revamping of many areas in the country's life. And you can also be like Hezekiah. Some of you are called to be in the marketplace, some of you are called into the ministry, in the house of God. But whatever it is, you can leave behind a great impact by doing what Hezekiah has done, revamping the 5 key areas. I'm sure if you read the story of Hezekiah, there are many, many more things that Hezekiah do. I just want to highlight 5 things. Number one, it can make a difference, leave a great impact by revamping, like Hezekiah did, temple sacrifices. 2 Chronicles 29, verse 3.
In the very first month of the first year of his reign, Hezekiah reopened the doors of the temple of the Lord and repaired them.
Notice the first month. So you give me the first month. It's like David, the first thing he did is to bring the ark from Kiriath-Jearim to Jerusalem, because he has a passion for God's house. The first thing that Hezekiah did, why is he so great? The first thing concerns the God's house. And in verse 6,
our ancestors were unfaithful and did what was evil in the sight of the Lord our God. They abandoned the Lord and his dwelling place. They turned their backs on him.
In fact, Hezekiah's father, the previous king, was one of the most wicked kings in Israel. Some of us know that just because he come from a dysfunctional family, it does not mean that you're going to have a dysfunctional life. You know, Paul Getty, the richest man in the world, he came from a dysfunctional family. The father was a womanizer, and she was raised up by Mother Eliza. But he didn't let that, what he had experienced, the father, the go on womanizing, he didn't allow that to sever his life. He rose to become the richest man in the world. At age 23, he was a millionaire, 50, a billionaire, and he gave away $5,000,000,000. It tells us one thing, just because you come from a dysfunctional family, does not mean you're going to have a dysfunctional life. Verse 7.
They also shut the doors to the temple's entry room and they snuffed out the lamps. They stopped burning incense and presenting burnt offerings at the sanctuary.
And the first thing that Hezekiah did to undo what the father did was to bring back temple sacrifices. Bring back the light. Now, how do we apply this in our daily life, practically in our daily life? Well, one of the greatest things you can do to revamp is to revamp the temple sacrifice. What is that? It's a picture of Christ's sacrifice on the cross. In other words, one of the things that you're going to cause you to be a great king in the marketplace is to keep presenting Christ. I'm not talking about your sacrifice. I'm talking about his sacrifice and to shine the light of Christ. Joy mentioned last week, what are the key reasons why Gideon got the victory? Because they blow the trumpet, which of course a picture of the ram's horn proclaiming what Christ has done, and shine the torch, which is to shine the light of Christ. Not our light, not showing how great we are. Oh, I sacrifice this, I sacrifice that. No, we talk about his sacrifice. You recall Jesus mentioned there was a man born of a woman, that no one is greater than this man that is born of a woman. None of the greatest man that ever lived. You know what Jesus said? He is John the Baptist. But the most amazing thing is that you don't find any miracles that John the Baptist did. You never hear of a parting of the Red Sea like Moses did. You never hear of healing the leper like Elijah the prophet did. There's nothing in terms of healing a miracle. The only one thing that is mentioned of John the Baptist is that he point people to Christ. Remember he said, I must decrease and he must increase. The only thing that John did, and I believe the key thing that you could do, able to do great impact in the marketplace, like what Hezekiah did, revamp temple sacrifice, point people to Christ. All right. The second thing that Hezekiah did that caused him to be such a great king, the greatest of all kings in the history of Israel, he revamped true worship. 2 Chronicles 29, verse 11.
My sons, do not neglect your duties any longer. The Lord has chosen you to stand in his presence, to minister to him, and to lead the people in worship and present offerings to him.
Notice the word repeated to him, to him. In other words, worship is unto God. Revamping worship, true worship, and the key to true worship is to be Christ-centered. That's why we always encourage our song leaders to choose song. They don't focus on what they can do, but what Christ has done. Christ-centered song. And then in verse 30.
Moreover, King Hezekiah and the leaders commanded the Levites to sing praise to the Lord with the words of David and of Asaph, the seer. So they sang praises with gladness, and they bowed their heads and worshipped.
You know, this is a command. The king gave the command that it must be worship, true worship, must be the word of God based. Not a human thinking, got to be based upon the word of God. So one of the things that you need to do, if you want to be like Hezekiah, to be the greatest, is to revamp worship in your life. When you go to the marketplace, go with worship. When you're driving, drive with worship. Praying in the Spirit, at the same time, you can make use of this book. We just selected some of the best songs that are Christ-centered, word-based. And it's available in the Resource Center. And if you get this book, Zone Pastors can also send you the soft copy. You can load it in your handphone. And I do that all the time when I'm doing my treadmill. I put my handphone in front of me and I will worship and praise. And half an hour, 45 minutes is gone very, very fast. And the song chosen are Christ-centered and word-centered. So you want to be great like Hezekiah, got to be revamping true worship in our place. And the next thing that Hezekiah did is to revamp their various types and offering. 2 Chronicles 29:31.
Then Hezekiah declared, now that you have consecrated yourselves to the Lord.
Consecrated. The word consecrated means to set apart, to be sacred, to be holy. Yeah, is in your notes. And it means to fulfill and complete and made whole. So one of the first things that Hezekiah did is to consecrate, asking the people to consecrate themselves to the Lord. And then another thing is, bring your sacrifices and thanksgiving offering to the temple of the Lord. And so the people brought their sacrifices and thanksgiving offering, and all whose heart were willing brought burnt offering too. The different types of offering that was being revamped by King Hezekiah. And one of the key description of all these various kind of offering is the thanksgiving offering. How many of us know you don't give to get? Of course, you're going to be blessing. But the main purpose is because we are giver because that's who we are. We give thanks to God for what Christ has done in our life. What happened is that King Hezekiah got the people first to consecrate themselves to God and also to consecrate the offering. That means when the offering was given, it's being consecrated. That means to be set apart. It means to be made sacred. It means to be complete. You can see that in Romans chapter 11, verse 16.
If the first portion of the dough offered is holy, then the whole batch is holy. And the root is holy, so too are the branches.
Holy, consecrated. It's the same meaning. One is Greek, one is Hebrew. And the kidding is, what has been given, of course, whatever you've given, whether it be tithes and offering, is holy, is sacred, is set apart. But most astoundingly, what remains? Your 90%. Or you give 20% tithe, your 80% is also sacred, holy, set apart. And it's going to come to completion, fullness of the purpose of why God gave us the money. And remember the first city that they conquered? And Joshua said in Joshua 6 verse 18,
"And you shall certainly keep clear of the devoted things, that you not become accursed by taking from the devoted things."
That Jericho was the first city they conquered. And God told Joshua, it is holy, it is devoted, it is set apart. Don't touch it. But you remember the first Chinaman in the Bible, Achan, took from the city of Jericho some clothing, some little bit of silver and gold. And the next city they tried to conquer, Ai, they were defeated. And the whole family was under a curse. Pastor, does it mean to say that if I don't give my tithe, I'm going to be under a curse? No, no, no. That is the wrong interpretation. What it meant here is that what you have given become holy. The city of Jericho has become holy. Anyone touches the city, including Achan, is going to be coming under God's curse. Same way, what you have given is holy. What remains in you is also holy. The 80%, 90% that are left, anyone supper touches that 80%, that 90%, incur God's wrath, incurs God's judgment. In other words, God will protect what remains in you because now it is holy, now it's devoted, now. Even if it's 80%, yes, 90% left, it is now sacred. Now it is devoted. It comes under God's protective shield. You don't worry about the enemy sabotaging your finances. And other people say, amen. And the same thing about tithing in Malachi 3. Many people got the wrong understanding. It says here, Malachi 3 verse 9, "You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation." Pastor, if I don't give my tithe, am I cursed? Actually, wrong interpretation. If you don't give your tithe, God is not causing you. Because it says you are cursed. Some of us know that is a passive voice. Say passive. None of it, you're really cursed. From the time of Adam, your forefather, our forefather, when Adam sinned, it's already cursed. So there's a reason why from the time sin entered the world, work become toil, become sweat, become stress, become distress. But how many of us know that tithe was instituted by God to break that curse, and other people say, amen. And it says here, "You're cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation." Again, very often, we wrongly interpret this passage and say, if we don't give our tithe, we're robbing God. Actually, the word God is not even in the Hebrew. I found out that just a couple of days ago. Look up the Hebrew. The word me, I put it in bracket now, it's not there in the original. In other words, when you don't give your tithe, you're not robbing God. Who are you robbing? You're robbing yourself. We are robbing ourselves when we hold back the tithe. And why are we robbing ourselves. Because look at the context, the people think they're robbing God. But God say, you are actually robbing yourself. Why? We didn't give our tithe. We are robbing ourselves. Because again, back to the story, in the beginning we mentioned, because the tithe has been consecrated, set apart, established by God as holy. In other words, we are taking that which is holy. Like a tithe, taking Jericho, which is holy. Because God has established that the tithe belongs to God. That's why we bring the tithe. So suppose I lend to Andrew my car. Then I say, hey Andrew, can I have my car back? Andrew said, okay, I give you this car. Andrew must know, he's insulting me. It's not his car. He bring the car back. So the tithe belongs to God. So you bring the tithe. The same thing, Hezekiah, bring the offering. Didn't say give offering. So when you don't give offering, you bring the offering, because that which we are supposed to give actually belong to God in the first place. Verse 10, Malachi chapter 3.
Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this. If I will not open for you the windows of heaven, and pour out for you such blessings that there will be not be room enough to receive it.
Notice it says that bring the whole tithe, bring all the tithe. And remember though, goes to God's house. And of course in our context will be the local church where you are being fed, we're being cared for. Watch this clip by Joseph Prince.
Now it's very easy to feel fed by me because I'm on TV twice a day, sometimes even more, every single day from Monday to Friday. And you watch me and you get feeding from me. And that's why I say at the end of the program, your tithes belong to your local church. But the Apostle Prince, there's no perfect church. There is no perfect church. And if you find a perfect church, you want to enter that church, let me tell you this. If you go to that church, it's no more perfect. Okay? So the thing is this, when God says tithes, He's talking about tithing to a church that's not perfect in the natural. But one thing about God is this, we who believe in grace, we must see the church as through the eyes of Jesus. You know how Jesus sees the church?
Amen. God sees us as righteous, of course. And why did God set the tithe apart as holy? Because that which remain is going to be blessed. In other words, that which remain, your 80%, your 90%, going to be consecrated. It means set apart. It means going to be reaching to the fullest of the potential of whatever that is left of that, what you have given, that 80%, 90% left. And verse 11 says, I will rebuild the devourer. In other words, those that sabotage or try to undermine you. Maybe you're on the time of promotion. Your colleague come and try to put all kind of evil thoughts on the boss. Man, you give me tithing, that colleague of yours, you got to pray for mercy. Because God says He will rebuild the devourer for your sake, so that He will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And so you see, as King Hezekiah revamped the various types of offering and consecrated. Remember, what remained behind is also consecrated. It's made holy, protected, shielded with great blessing. And then verse 6 of 2 Chronicles 30, what happened as they rewound the offering?
There was great joy in the city, for Jerusalem had not seen a celebration like this.
And then the priests and the Levite begin to bless the people. And this is what we call the Abrahamic blessing. Remember, Deuteronomy 8:18, God give us the anointing to get wealth. You know, some people say, well, Pastor, tithing is actually Old Testament. Yeah, even before Moses was born, Abraham gave his tithe. Tithing will go on until the second coming of Christ. Because look at the context of Malachi chapter 3, look at verse 1. Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to the temple. Definitely, this refers to the second coming, because in the first coming, it was not sudden. He was in and out of the temple, Jesus Christ, in his first coming, and Bible tells us he will come suddenly. And he was talking about, look at the call, the tithing, talking about the second coming. Because some of them, though, God calls us to be blessed in the last days. In the midst of the deepest darkness, Isaiah 60 verse 1, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness. There's going to be deep darkness. In fact, there are two words, the Hebrew word used. One is darkness, the other one is deep darkness. And fake darkness is a darkness that you can almost touch, you can almost feel. And today we see that darkness in moral degeneration, in our midst, the oppressive feeling that you felt, and that depression. The word deep darkness means being oppressed, being distressed, and disappointment, sadness. Especially when you read the paper, you have high hope, but you get disappointed. And the Bible says, in the midst of that thick darkness, the Bible tells us, the Lord will rise over you. Say, the Lord will rise over you, and His glory will be seated upon you. In other words, in the midst of the darkest time, in the last day, God say He's going to release His greatest blessing. Like Armageddon, Lord Joy talked about it last week, talking about Jezreel Valley, which is of course the Hebrew name for the Greek word Armageddon, which Magad means prosperity, Arm is mountain, mountain of abundance. And then I tell you this, that in the last day, the Midianites, we can remember the word Midian, Joy mentioned, means harassment, strife. And all the strife, all the harassment, all the oppression, the deep darkness. And then the word Midian also means judgment, when the world is being judged. Some of us know it's a time for us to expect great abundance in the last days. Verse 4, lift up your eyes all around and see. They will gather together, never come to you. Your sons will come from afar, and your daughters will be nursed at your side. In other words, last days, prosperity, it's not just about money, it includes money, but it's going to be great, great restoration of relationship. Verse 5, then you shall see and become radiant, and your heart will swell with joy, because of the abundance of the sea will be turned to you, and the wealth of the Gentiles will come to you. And just talk about the last day, that there's going to be the greatest transfer of wealth. What we have seen, time of Moses, is a national scale. But we're going to see in the last day, there's going to be the international transfer of wealth from the wicked to the just. You can see that on a national scale in Exodus 11, where God said, I'm going to release the last plague, and Pharaoh will let you go. But as your neighbor, for all the gold and all the silver. And verse 3 of Exodus 11.
The Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians.
So you mean the Lord gave favor. So first, I don't know why. I got promoted, you know. I don't have what it takes. I don't have the qualification. But I got it. But I don't know why. People want to do business with me. The people just corrupt. Hey, I got this deal. I want you to do that deal. Hey, how many of us know that is supernatural favor? And verse 4, then Moses said, thus says the Lord God, about midnight I will go out into the midst of Egypt. Midnight, say midnight. It's the darkest time. How many must know it's the darkest time that the greatest transfer of wealth will take place? The same thing in Matthew 27. Remember, at noontime, the brightest time of the day become the darkest time. The midday become midnight. It is when the lamb was being sacrificed. Hey, put this way, it's the natural lamb that the roasted time Moses brought such amazing transfer of wealth. How much more the Lamb of God that took away our sin. So we're expecting great transfer of wealth. We see that in the Proverbs 13 verse 22.
A good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, but the wealth of the sinner is stored up for the righteous.
And then James talked about it also, and he referred it to the last day. He talked about your gold and silver are corroded. Talk about the wicked, and their corrosion will be a witness against you, and it will eat your flesh like fire. You have heaped up your treasure in the last day. Some of us know the wicked going to heap up treasure in the last day. Some of us know purpose. Transfer it to the righteous, and we are the righteous in Christ, and all the believers say. The key is being faithful. Remember Jesus Christ said in Luke chapter 6 verse 12,
and if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own?
If God is planning the greatest transfer of wealth from the wicked to the just, who would he be entrusting that riches? Surely it's going to be people that are faithful in their tithes and their offering, in their giving. Giving of a guy named Mr. William Colgate that has been a tither all his life. During his life, he gave 5/10 of his income. And years later, he revealed why he has such a passion for giving. Because when he was 16 years of age, he left home. Oh, but how many of us know, no matter how young you may be, God can raise you up to be his entrepreneur. At age 16, Mr. Colgate tried to find opportunity in New York and take a boat. And the boat captain told him this advice. And it's here written, someone will soon be the leading soup maker in New York. This is what the captain said prophetically to Mr. Colgate. You can be that person. How many of us know that God is looking for the greatest king? Would you be that greatest king? God is looking for people like Hezekiah. Would you revamp tithes and offering in your life? Someone is going to be the leading soup maker in New York. You can be that person. Challenge from another boat captain. But you must never lose sight of the fact that the soup you make has been given to you by God. Honor him by sharing what you earn. Begin by tithing all that you receive. This is why he was passionate. Mr. Colgate is known for his tithing. During his life, he gave almost everything away. Same thing with James Kraft. How many have taken Kraft cheese? Yeah? And how many have taken your ketchup? Hens. John Henry Hens. They all started giving their tithe, 10%, and then towards the end of their life, they give almost everything. And I think it was Carl Menningel who said, money giving is a good criterion of a person's mental health. Generous people are rarely mentally ill. And all the mentally normal persons say, and then the next thing, Hezekiah, how did Hezekiah be so great? He revamped the offering, he revamped worship, he revamped sacrifice, highlighting Christ's work. He revamped the priesthood and the Levites. And as the offering was being established, the king was able to revamp the priests and the Levites, have better and have more priests and Levites. He said, see that in 2 Chronicles 31 verse 2, Hezekiah then organized the priests and Levites in the division to offer the burnt offering and peace offering and to worship and to give thanks. And one of the things that as kings, one of the great call is to revamp the priests and the Levites. Today, contact will be the zone pastors as well as the administrative staff, getting the best people, the cream of the crop, to serve in the local church. You recall when Joseph Brin took off from his high-paying job, cut down perhaps 70% of his pay, joined the local church, and he shared, he counted not as a sacrifice, but as a great joy and a great privilege. Of course, today his ministry is tremendously prosperous. And I hope no one in our church called to serve as zone pastor or in the administrative staff would have to go through what Joseph Brin has gone through or to go through what we have gone through, that because of the tithes and offering you have been giving, we are able to pay them well. Because when you pay peanut, what do you get? Mere monkeys. And all the monkeys, all the people say, amen. Today's context, I believe God is revamping, raising up the best zone pastor, the best administrative staff to serve his house, and all the people say. The next thing that King Hezekiah do, before that, Pastor Kerry already mentioned about the partnership between the kings and the priests. The job of the king is to bring the tithes and offering, the various of offering to the house of God, that we're able to develop the best and more priests and Levites in the house of God. The next thing that Hezekiah did is to revamp the Passover and establishing and celebrating the Passover in the right way. You know, sometimes, of course, the Passover here, in our context with the Holy Communion, very often many places, they don't have Holy Communion every week. Because, you got to examine yourself. Some churches even once a year, and very often once a month. Because, oh man, you got to examine yourself. But how about us though, to revamp the Holy Communion the right way, to revamp the Passover the right way, you see that in 2 Chronicles 30 verse 18.
For a multitude of the people had not cleansed themselves, yet they ate the Passover contrary to what was written. But Hezekiah prayed for them, saying, May the good Lord provide atonement for everyone who prepares his heart to seek God, the Lord God of his fathers, though he is not cleansed according to the purification of the sanctuary. And the Lord listened to Hezekiah and healed the people.
Hallelujah. Now, the people are thinking about themselves, whether they have cleansed themselves as people who take the Passover. But the point is that when you take the Holy Communion, it's not about you, how clean you are. It's about how good the sacrifice is. So important when you come to take the Holy Communion, don't focus on your sin. Pastor, you know I did bad thing. All the more, you need to come for Holy Communion because Jesus said, this is my blood shed for you for what? How good you are? For the forgiveness of what? Your sin. So the more you felt unworthy, the more you take Holy Communion. But Pastor, Pastor's here. You don't take it with worthily. You're going to incur judgment, not discerning the body. It's not about how good you are, how pure you are, because we don't recognize the body. We don't discern the body. Recognize it as the very body and the blood of Christ shed for us for the forgiveness of our sins. So Hezekiah revamped the Passover, in our context, Holy Communion, and instituted it, revamped it to be celebrated the right way. And as a result of this five great revamping and restoration, we see amazing, amazing construction in the lifetime of Hezekiah. Those of you who have been to Holy Land, you see the Hezekiah's Tunnel, you see? One of the greatest projects, most amazing engineering in world history is the Hezekiah's Tunnel. It's astounding. I mean, it's bring water from the valley right up 3,000 feet to Jerusalem. That's awesome. It is an amazing construction. But in the midst of the construction, there were great challenges. There was a guy, a Syrian, but they never sent a cherub. How many heard of the cherub? When I was in primary school, we read of the Sennacherib Nebuchadnezzar. That sounds very hard to remember name, but I remember it. How many of you remember when you were in the... I remember standard five where we study Sennacherib and Hammurabi and also Nebuchadnezzar. Nowadays, the younger generation didn't study that. You don't have Sennacherib Nebuchadnezzar. But we studied that when we were standard five, history. And when I discovered that actually these names are also in the Bible, I got excited. And it was this king had done great revamp and great construction. And the devil come in the form of Sennacherib to harass King Hezekiah and intimidate Hezekiah's people. Officer from Sennacherib came and intimidate God's people. Man, if I give you 2,000 horses, you can't find enough riders to ride on it. And of course, the officer of Hezekiah was panicked. He said, please, don't talk in Hebrew. The people can understand you. Talk in Aramaic. He's stupid. I mean, they're not going to listen to him because, how many must know, you cannot negotiate with the devil. You know, sometimes people try to cast out demons. Name yourself. Oh, I am a demon with a lying spirit. Come out, lying spirit. Then after 6 hours, cussing, still cannot. You know why? Because you stupid believe a lying spirit. You don't talk to the devil. I heard the story of this Carita, who was a prostitute, but was put in the jail. He was being demonized, and there are two very horrifying spirits biting her, and she had all kind of bite marks, the neck, the back, the front, everywhere. Her face and blood just oozed out. And one of the doctors treating her said, oh, you're just making it up. You just want to get attention. And she, with a bitter hatred, looked at the doctor, you're going to die. 2 days' time, the doctor just died, mysteriously, without any sickness. And then a prison officer began to kind of discipline her because she was attacking people. And with great hatred, with a sneakish serpent-like eye, she said, you're going to die. And the prison officer just died mysteriously in 4 days. And so there was panic in the whole prison. And it was in the paper and the television, and came to the knowledge of Pastor Lester Sumner. I got an opportunity to eat with him one day. He prayed over me, in part, whatever he has. And Lester Sumner came over, got the permission from the mayor to pray for her, and opened her mouth, and it was blasphemy against Jesus, blasphemy against God, and she spoke in perfect English. The fact is that she can't speak English. It was a demon speaking. But of course, the name of Jesus stronger. To cut the story short, Pastor Lester Sumner, in the name of Jesus, delivered that lady. She was totally healed. She said the spirit has left her. And the mayor was so impressed and arranged, processed the land for Lester Sumner to build what is today one of the largest churches in the Philippines, the Cathedral of Praise. How many of us know God is greater? And so the intimidation came from Senator Cherub, but the officer of King Hezekiah tried to talk with them. You don't negotiate the devil. What Hezekiah did, Hezekiah said in 2 Chronicles 32, verse 7,
"Be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid or discouraged because of the king of Assyria or his mighty army, for there is a power far greater on our side. He may have a great army, but they are merely men. We have the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles for us." Hezekiah's words greatly encouraged the people.
What Hezekiah is trying to tell the people is that the problem may be big, but our God is almighty. The problem are no match, because we have Yahweh. We have the covenant-keeping God. And so the Hezekiah's word, that is from God's word and from God's promises, that pointing the people to a great God and the great promises encourage the people. The same way we always recollect what Pastor Vincent prophesied. In the midst of all the challenges, you recall Pastor Vincent said, "Tell your children they have a future here because God has promised what he's going to do. They have a very good future." Have you told your children? Yes, they have a great future here. And then there's a Pastor Vincent prophesied over us. Isaiah the prophet prophesied over King Hezekiah that Senator Cherub guy, you're going to go back and he's going to be slaughtered in his own hometown. And true enough, the next day, the angel of the Lord came and finished off. If you look at 2 Kings chapter 19, 185,000 soldiers. And shortly after that, Senator took off back to his hometown. He was worshiping in the temple. And it's all recorded in history. Yeah, look up. And two of his son killed him. How many must know God is well able to protect you when you are under that protective shield? You recall King Hezekiah revamped the offering, consecrated the offering, and he has that special covering. There was this friend from Singapore, Pastor Prince, I believe, who was sharing how in Indonesia, he used to go to that church to preach. This is a pastor that was really a man of God. He just wanted people to be healed, blessed. But he experienced some opposition, and his heart is broken, not because he was being hurt, but because he knows the people that oppose God's work is going to be hurt. And he's going to experience terrible thing. And true enough, this guy, when that pastor was talking about Holy Communion, about the anointing oil, he walked out of the church angrily. Shortly after that, he was at the traffic light, timber truck pulled by. So happened, the chain broke loose, and the lock crushed the car. All the family gone. Another thing is, this guy write terrible thing about the ministry. The pastor has forgiven him. But he was heartbroken because he knows people are going to be hurt when they're coming against the ministry of God. What happened is that he wrote negative thing, and shortly after that, he was in the parking lot, multi-story car park. He reverses the car, but unfortunately, it breaks the barrier. The whole car plunged down, and all the occupants finished. The point is, Haman must know God is well able to protect what you have, when what you have given is holy and what remains is holy, and other people say. And I was also told by that friend that, you know, when a medium is being asked to charm somebody, Very often he asked the question, is a person going to be charmed a Christian? If it's a Christian, he refused to be charming that person because the demon will go. And then all that the person needs to do is, Jesus! And the demons will have to run back and he will attack the medium and the person who wanted to charm the person. So how many of us know you are protected? You are protected. And so Hezekiah revamped five things. I believe much more, but there are the five things that I want to highlight. He encountered great construction. Yeah, there are opposition, but God protected him. But despite of that, he has a fair share of weaknesses. That's why Proverbs 14:15 says,
only simpletons believe everything they are told. The prudent carefully consider their steps.
How many of us know we are called to be simple, but not simplistic? In your notes, I put down, being nice is good, but being naive is foolish. Being simple is preferred, but being simplistic, how many of us know, is advised. So Hezekiah had some striking weaknesses in his life, despite of what he has done in terms of revamping. Number one, he was investing in the wrong place. He was paying, trying to appease Sennacherib. God had given him the victory. One fiat of the angel, 185,000 of them was finished, and yet he tried to invest, pay tribute to Sennacherib. And today we have people give in to all the scams. And you know, some of these people I noticed, they are very stringent with their money. I'm not saying they are stingy, I'm saying stringent. How come they got into the wrong investment, got into all this scam? You read the paper, one of the reasons is fear. Same with Hezekiah, he was out of fear that he gave to Sennacherib. And sometimes people fall to the scam, it's because of greed. They want a quick fix to the financial situation. So it was a plunder that Hezekiah made, investing in the wrong place and mixing with the wrong people. 2 Kings chapter 18 tells us he was trying to have an alliance with Egypt, which is the picture of the world. And the Bible tells us in Proverbs that he who walks with the wise will become wise, but a companion of fool will be destroyed. No, you mix with negative people. You can't mix with people that they're in their negative, pouring out all the poison of negativity and expect a positive life. And Hezekiah tried to make an alliance with Egypt, but it didn't work. And he was also not discerning who the real enemy is. 2 Kings chapter 20, verse 12, you can read out that the king of Babylon, now this is not Sennacherib, now it's Nebuchadnezzar. Yeah? And he heard that Hezekiah was very sick and recovered. He sent an envoy and with some gift and wishes. Beware of flattery. People come to you and say, wow, how good you are. You're a sympathetic person. You listen to all my hurt, all my pain. Flattery. And what Hezekiah did, he showed the envoy everything he possessed. Azar the prophet came along and said, all the things are going to be taken by the king of Babylon. Now, it's not a curse. Azar didn't give the curse. All right? It's just that it's just a natural consequence of thing. Today, how do we apply this? How do we show all the treasures in our house, in our palace? Today, we do it by posting in the social media. Nothing wrong when you eat something good, take a picture, or go somewhere, take a picture. That's okay. But some people, when they take a picture, they make sure that Louis Vuitton bag is noticeable. They make sure that Ferragamo shoe, not Bata shoe, is shown. And it's basically the pride of life. Sometimes when they take a picture, make sure it's some celebrity, somebody big to show that they have good connection. Hey, how many of us know it's not going to be good? And so, young ladies also, careful what you post, because now with this app, they can actually take what you have taken, a very decent picture, and make you a naked model. So this is a reality, and you have to be careful. And what happened is that Hezekiah was not very alert, this is the area, and one day, in 2 Kings 20, verse 1 says,
in those days, Hezekiah was sick and near death. And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amoz, went to him and said to him, thus says the Lord, set your house in order, for you shall die and not live.
What was in disorder? Set your house in order. That means there's something in disorder. It's no mention. Since it's not mentioned in the Bible, don't speculate. It could be one of the reasons above. We don't know. And how many of us know we are living in imperfect world? Sometimes as kings, even myself, make poor choices. And the thing is, we don't judge Hezekiah. And sometimes you kings in the marketplace, you may make a wrong investment. That's fine. Don't condemn yourself. Maybe you mix it the wrong people. That's fine. Turn away from it. Move on. Mix it the right people. And you've been trying to show off. It's a pride of life. Can steer away from it. Kidding is, we as kings and priests in the marketplace, in his house, we make bad choices. And when the king was being told by Isaiah the prophet, his life is finished with him. Look at verse 2. When Hezekiah heard this, he turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. Remember, O Lord, how I have always been faithful to you and have served you, single-heartedly, always doing what pleases to you. How many of us know when he pleaded that, he was doing something biblical, because the Bible tells us in Proverbs, a faithful man will abound with many blessings. He was faithful, he was revamping, he did a great thing. But suddenly he realized, when he was telling God how good he was, he also realized he made major blunders. Then he realized that he cannot go further. And the Bible tells us, he broke down and he cried bitterly. He went to God telling all the things that he has done. Began to realize, hey, that is not going to be convincing, because he also done that thing. Finally, he broke down and wept bitterly. Some of us know, when we are unfaithful, the Bible tells us he remains faithful because he cannot deny himself. 2 Timothy 2:13. And Hezekiah broke down. What that means is he rested in God's grace. He has an encounter with his grace, and that is all that is needed. I saw the prophet was at the door of the palace when God said, make a U-turn. So he made a U-turn, went back, and he told Hezekiah, God has answered your prayer. God is going to heal you. None of that, he also gave a sign. That the sundial, don't say we don't have a clock. They have a sundial. The sundial, the shadow that is made by the sundial, is to go back 10 steps. That's awesome, man. A lot of commentators try to give all kind of explanation. But the fact is that the shadow goes back 10 steps. How many of you remember the 2004 tsunami, the Great Indian Ocean, where there was an earthquake of 9.3 on the Richter scale, and even here we can feel it. That you recall on that day, Boxing Day, we thought there was some problem, but actually the whole screen shake, and it's so powerful. 60-foot wave higher than this building, and 230,000 people died. And the power of that earthquake is about 23,000 Hiroshima bomb. And yet that amazing power only vibrated the earth 1 cm. The earth tilted only a few microns. And can you imagine when Hezekiah rested in grace? He broke down in tears, resting in his grace. Not talking about how good he is, what he has done, but resting in his grace. God reversed the sun, or rather the earth rotation. 9 steps! How much energy that is needed to do that? All right, commentators will try to give an intellectual answer. Let's take it the Bible as it is. God releases the greatest power of the universe in your favor. And other people say, Pastor, it's too late. I lost my health. I lost my family. I lost my wealth. I lost my honor. It's finished with me. The God who can reverse time can come into your life and release the greatest power to move on your behalf. And other people say. And the last verse I'm going to read to you today. 2 Chronicles 31:21. And in every work that he began in the service of the house of God, in the law and in the commandment to seek his God, he did it with all his heart. Pastor, is God blind? Didn't we see the Bible? He did so many bad things. Let me tell you this, he couldn't see. Why he couldn't see? because it's covered. Romans chapter 4 verse 7, blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven, whose sins are covered. I must know, when you come to God and rest in His grace, God cannot see the bad and ugly choices you have made. The key thing is rest in His grace. Verse 8, blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. And man, when we rely on Him, you see the greatest breakthrough in our other people's eh? Surprised to learn Hezekiah was the greatest king. Because the first month of his reign, unlike his father, he revamped temple sacrifice. You want to be great like Hezekiah? Maybe you don't want to be the greatest king, but you want to be a mover and shaker in the marketplace. To be the head, not the tail. Point Jesus, point people to Christ. Lift Him up like John the Baptist. And revamp worship that is Christ-centered, word-based. Revamp the sacrifices. Revamp the Holy Communion. Sacrifice the ways of grace. Revamp, partner kings and priests in close intimacy, that the best people may be employed in the house of God with the best that we can offer. And other people say, Amen. Would you pray this prayer together with me? Dear Lord Jesus, thank You for being my good shepherd. Right now, I receive You into my life as my shepherd, as my Lord. Thank You, Lord Jesus. I know even I make bad choices, You are with me, You are for me, and You will sort things out for me, because You are the good shepherd who have already laid down Your life for me. And other people say, Amen.
Like a river, a tender flowing, where sorrows like sea billows roll. Whatever, my Lord, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well
If you have said that prayer and want to know more, or have any feedbacks, please write to us.